I was very pleased when Dave told me the name of his panel, that the session that I would be participating in, because the title of my dissertation, which is currently being transformed into a book too slowly, is High Weirdness. And one of the things that I want to do in this project is to add a little heft to the concept of the weird, to give it a little ontological depth. And ontology is just a fancy way of talking about being, the idea that what we refer to as the weird actually has something to tell us about what is real. And the weird is an interesting term. It has a lot of ambiguity. It can be a place where we shuttle things away. Oh, that was kind of a weird experience, something we don't really know what to do with. Somebody who's a little bit strange, unpleasant, maybe is weird, but it's also something that we enjoy. It has an aesthetic quality, and as I will argue, though, it also has something very deeply to tell us about the nature of reality. If you were here for Dennis's talk before, I looked very closely at the experiment in my dissertation, so I spent a lot of time reading all those texts very closely and thinking about them, and Dennis laid out a triumvirate of possibilities: psychosis, alien abduction, shamanic initiation, i.e. rationalist deconstruction, paranormal weirdness, or paranormal experience, or a religious experience. And for me, the weird is precisely the ambivalence or ambiguity between all those three possibilities. Weirdness is the suspension or the unity of the difference. And there's two reasons that I'm really interested in the weird, particularly in the context of this conference. One is because I'm interested in navigating between two Scylla and two Charybdis seas, or Charybdi. One has to do with psychedelic discourse. And on one side, we have the normalization of medical discourse, in which psychedelics are helpful, useful, utility for psychological reasons and creativity, and in some ways, capitalist production. And on the other hand, we have an increasingly robust religious discourse around indigenous wisdom, connections with the goddess, connections with the spirit of the plants within an increasingly ritual format, such to the extent that it's very easy to imagine, at least in the American condition, that in the future I could take psychedelics legally under two circumstances. One, in which I submit myself to the authority of the state as a license-granting body who elects certain individuals as doctors who can allow me to take drugs, or I can go and submit myself to the authority of a church structure which is recognized by the state as having the right to produce these religious rites. Whereas what I'm interested in is the path between. And I'm interested in the path between not just because I think that psychedelics precisely point us to something between these two domains, but that it has something even more to do in terms of our cultural experience, in terms of the ability to be a lay psychedelic experiencer who's interested in the full range of experiences, the sacred and profane combined into a deeper sacred. But I think that this middle path also tells us something about reality, and this is the second Scylla and Charybdis. On the one hand, a physicalist account of what's going on in reality, something that our reason and rationality can tell us about causality and necessity, and so we can reduce all of this phenomena to some kind of information processing or Bayesian selection scheme or some kind of psychological process that is amenable to rational discourse. And again, on the other side, there's some transcendent possibility. There's some alternate dimensions. There's some mystical other world. There's some transcendental function. And what I'm interested in is the space in between. The weird for me is a zone, and it's a little bit more on the naturalist side. I'm really interested in figuring out if it's not the case that reality itself, as Dennis also talked about, the reality itself is just weirder than we think it is. And so that by pursuing the weird, we find ourselves expanding the very nature of naturalism into something that is still amenable to science, but takes the ontological claims of these religious or spiritual experiences more seriously. So that's my main zone in terms of the weird. And I'll try to, I probably will not get through this whole thing, but we'll just see where we go. So I'm interested in tracing the weird, and if you look at the weird as a term, it's a very interesting one. You know, if we go back to the language of Beowulf, weird is a noun that's referring to fate, right? And so we associate that, you know, we can look at the three fates, a sort of pan-European a triumvirate of ladies who are weaving reality. So it's associated with fate, with doom, with necessity. And yet there's something interesting going on here. One of the Norns is named Earth, which is sometimes seen as a cognate of the word weird in Old English. And the word Earth actually means a twist or a turn. And so what I'm interested here is not just the invocation of necessity, which is also an invocation of causality and that kind of rational world of we understand the causes, why A leads to B. But there's something twisting and turning in here, something a bit odd, something a bit strange. Now, we know these three figures a little bit better, at least in English literature, because they become the weird sisters in Shakespeare's Macbeth, which is probably the first time that the weird becomes an adjective. Again, we have this sort of association here with the spectral, with the supernatural, with you know, the creepy. And even in the representations of this Shakespearean scene, we can already start to tune into the aesthetic of the weird, something a little disturbing, peculiar, strange, and bizarre. The flourishing of the term weird into our more modern senses of the term really takes a turn with the Romantics, and particularly with Shelley, who uses it in a number of different poems in interesting ways that are worth referring to. I wanted to mention one other thing about the witches, though. One thing that's very peculiar, I didn't say weird, about Shakespeare's Macbeth is that in the original folio, he never spells it W-E-I-R-D. And those who know your Shakespeare know that the spellings vary quite a bit. But in some of their variations, the weird becomes very much like wayward. And wayward is a term that Shakespeare used often to denote a kind of turn away from the norm, a sort of resistance or deviance from the norm. And so that's very interesting. Weird is at once fate, necessity, and this turn or twist away from the norm. And it's in that variation that we're going to see a lot of the weird. So on to Shelley. He talks about he compares himself to some weird archmage plotting dark spells and devilish enginery. So if you see the way that Romanticism is allowing a lot of what had been repressed in the turn to the Enlightenment and the turn to rationalism back into the mind, you know, the spooks, the specters, the indigenous, the erotic, the irrational, is sort of becomes in as a sort of literary principle, that the weird is part of that process. In the Witch Atlas, he talks about quote, tale more fit for weird winter nights than for these garish summer days when we scarcely believe much more than we can see. So the weird is associated not only with the nighttime and with those things that we don't know because we can't see, but the weird is also a kind of tale. The weird is also an aesthetic form, a narrative form, so that we can say that the weird, the sisters in Shakespeare's Macbeth are not just weird. Macbeth itself is weird. It's a weird tale. And this sort of weird telling moves into literature. We have the growth of the Gothic with the strange, tales of perverted monks and ghosts and haunted castles. This transforms in the 19th century through penny dreadfuls and the sort of arcana of low-rent imaginative thrills, giving us ultimately the supernatural tale and in some sense its ultimate incarnation in the dubious literature, as mentioned by Dennis again, of weird tales. Now, so already we can see the way that the weird as something lowbrow, something pulpy, something not really for polite society, also becomes a vehicle for encounters with, strange, somewhat serpentine, flute-playing entities that are both associated with some kind of weird UFO beam, but also a foresty kind of elven creepiness, not completely unfamiliar. But of course, the weird tales is most associated with, arguably the great master of the weird, H.P. Lovecraft. And Lovecraft wrote, not only write a lot for Weird Tales, but he wrote this book about supernatural horror in literature, where he talks a great deal about the weird tale, sort of establishing the weird tale as a modern way of understanding this stream of irrational or dream-haunted literature. So he asked himself, what makes a tale a weird tale? Quote, "The one test of the really weird is simply this: whether or not there be excited in the reader a profound sense of dread and of contact with unknown spheres and powers, a subtle attitude of awed listening, as if for the beating of black wings or the scratching of outside shapes and entities on the known universe's utmost rim." So again, we're drawn to a margin, the edge of the rational, the edge of the known universe, at which we encounter some kind of implication, some kind of sense of an outside, of a beyond, which we can't really cohere or crystallize, and yet we remain marked by it emotionally and cognitively. It's not just emotional, not just dread and spookiness, but it's also cognitive. It's an encounter with the outside, with unknown spheres. And in talking more about the weird tale, Lovecraft mentions something very key. He says the weird tale isn't just in the land of fantasy. It's always about a certain tension between the fantastical or the anomalous or the unpredictable and a more realistic account. Those of you familiar with Lovecraft stories, and I'm sure many of you here are, know that they have, you know, part of some of them even have almost like a detective function, where there's sort of a rational process as a researcher is discovering new information, very convinced that their sort of mundane reality is true reality, and then we get to see it interrupted, and even long before they recognize the reality of the bizarreness, we already, you know, we're clued into the plot, as it were. And this tension between realism and the otherworldly is precisely the domain of the weird. There's always both ends of the spectrum. And indeed, one of his more famous lines about the weird tale, Lovecraft talked about that how it must be rooted in the real and, quote, devised with all the care and verisimilitude of a hoax. And even with that hoax, we're having a sense again of this trickster, mischievous quality of weird literature. This is just an example of that. I'm going to skip that. 20th century, the uncanny. Now, many of you, you know, if you studied literature in college, you read your Freud, whatever, you've encountered the concept of the uncanny. The uncanny has to do with the strange, the strange but familiar, like a doll, something that seems alive but isn't alive, or strange experiences of recurrence, which Freud talks about in his famous essay, you know, coming across the same number or wandering in a city and keep finding yourself in the same spot over and over again. This feeling of the uncanny, which he associated with the return of the repressed, with a repetition compulsion, and ultimately with the death drive. But the uncanny is a nice, well-established, well-defined concept, and I want to put forward to you that the weird has a great deal to do with the uncanny, but that the uncanny is also a kind of highbrow repression of the full force of the weird. So we could see the weird as kind of like the uncanny's sort of crass country cousin. And I say that not just because the culture of the weird does not, you know, if we talk about uncanny literature, we're talking about Borges, so we're talking about Bruno Schultz, we're talking about literature, about sort of highbrow stuff, psychoanalysis, etc. But if we're talking about weird literature, we're talking about comic books, we're talking about monster magazines, you know, we're talking about, you know, sort of imagery from weird subcultures and kind of demotic worlds. So in one sense, the weird, you know, kind of covers a lot of the same territory of the uncanny as an experience. But there's two other dimensions of the weird that make it more significant in my mind. One is that it is not so psychoanalytic. It has more to do with actual matter, that there's something material about weirdness that is sort of foreclosed by the slightly more effete qualities of the uncanny, or slightly more psychological qualities of the uncanny. But perhaps an even more important element than this materiality, this relationship to nature, to naturalism, to physical bodies, and the way that physical bodies can sort of go off kilter and get out of our conventional structures of reality, perhaps more important to this is the association with social deviancy. a weirdo back in the early 20th century was often seen as a peculiar person, perhaps even a sexual pervert. And indeed, there's a connection between weirdness and the queer. And if you're at all familiar with the theoretical sort of discussion of queerness, we can see a lot of cross registers, although this is, of course, is the weird is not so directly related to the particular challenges of homosexuality, but there's a lot of relationship there in terms of social deviance. So a weirdo is someone who's against cultural norms, twists away from convention. Again, remember the names of the weird sisters and the idea that the weird twists away, a wayward turn away from the norm. And that becomes a sort of social position as well as an aesthetic. It becomes a way of engaging with matter as well as an engaging with narrative. And this, you know, helps us understand the weird aspect of the psychedelic revolution, the hippie revolution in the 60s. This is not the story that is brought forward by many of our memories today. Just the same way that the contemporary psychedelic story tends to be normalized through either a sort of medical language of healing, and neuroscientific information, or a religious language of sacred healing, another kind of healing, or some kind of connection with indigenous wisdom. There is a secular, demotic, underground, scrappy, scruffy, snarky, countercultural strand of psychedelia that I'm associating with the weird. And I'm partly doing this because I remain a deeply committed tribal member of this current, that despite the calls from Ben Sessa and other people to put the 70s counterculture away from contemporary psychedelia, I will remain always a tribal member and therefore an aficionado. Okay, I'm going to go really quick through this just as here an example of how weirdness becomes a social cultural position. This is self-consciously lowbrow too, not a highbrow zone. This is, Crum did this in the 80s, shows how the weird becomes increasingly demotic, increasingly not related to the spectral and mystical sides of, say, the weird sisters. However, there's always a sacred trace, for it was in Weirdo magazine that one of R. Crum's greatest creations took place, which was the illustration of Philip K. Dick's religious experience. So here we have a trace of the sacred within the context of the weird. And of course, there's no time to go into Dick's experiences now. I just want to, appropriate response. I want to emphasize one famous line is that Dick talked about how this in our world, that the symbols of the divine initially appear in the trash stratum. And that tension between the divine and trash, or in Mircea Eliade's famous terms, between the sacred and the profane, is the weird. And I would suggest it's actually a deeper sacred, which is simultaneously a form of the profane. And it's in that dynamic, that dialectic, that twist, that the absurdity that Dennis talked about takes place. And indeed, the very way in which psychedelics modulate between very physical experiences, their molecules, we're metabolizing in our bodies, they're kind of gooey. If you take ayahuasca, you're puking, maybe you're shitting, and it's bleh. So you're in this stuff, and at the same time, there's this profound transcendent dimension. So I'm skipping the UFOs. What I call weird naturalism, and this is sort of a slightly more robust claim for the ontological force of the weird. This is Melanowski. Anthropologist, early anthropologist, studying the folks in the Trobriand Islands, and he was analyzing magical speech. He was like, what makes the magician's speech different than ordinary language? How can we talk about this sort of sacred power of the performance of magical language? And he came up with a way of, so he started to analyze how magical language that the magicians would use to make crops grow or whatever differed from their ordinary language. And what he found is that there's sort of a zone of deviation again, of deformation, of twisting or turning, you know, kind of abracadabra or barbarous tongues, if you know your esoterica, ways of mutating normal conventional language in a way that produces this strange kind of performative power. Malinowski had a great name for this process, which he called the coefficient of weirdness. The coefficient of weirdness. And what I love about this idea is that the idea that the weird can be quantized, that we can understand the weird as a statistical deviation. And indeed, we just saw Dave Luke talking about the way in which we use statistics and statistical deviation to approach the weirdness of paranormal experience. We have to. We have no choice other than to do it statistically. And then through that process, we encounter this strange, wonderful term and category of the anomaly. The anomaly. How do we think about anomalies? What are they? Are they part of the world? Do they gesture outside of the world? Are they really anomalous, or do we just perceive anomaly? And I want to suggest that the anomaly, the category of the anomaly, not just in the way in which we use it to understand paranormal things, to understand physics, but the very category itself, the fact that there are always anomalies, however much science wants to explain them away, there's always more anomalies, that is partly the stitch, the nature of reality, that we're partly in this anomalous situation. And of course, you know, the greatest anomalies, as folks have mentioned and folks know, is quantum physics. I'm not going to go into anything about entanglement, whatever, don't have time. However, I do want to note that the term quantum weirdness is used not just by physicists, not just by journalists, but also by physicists to talk about these spooky properties of entanglement, of the indeterminacy, et cetera, et cetera. You kind of probably mostly know the score, at least on a surface level. So this is a very interesting phrase. Like, where did this come from? Who first started talking about quantum weirdness? It appears widely in Heinz Pagel's, a physicist, popular book from the early 80s, but it goes back to the 70s in a couple of interesting ways, one of which I think is really worth going into a little bit, and I need to pull up my notes because it involves some quotes. So the philosopher Hilary Putnam was writing about a very famous essay by Quine on two dogmas of empiricism. And I wanted to, if you don't know this stuff, don't worry about it, but Quine was, you know, Anglo-American, rational, you know, nothing fuzzy, no Nietzsche, nothing like that. This is like hardcore, real analytic philosophy. But Quine was like, you know, all of these things that we think of as laws, that we describe as laws, you know, they're actually a little bit more like historical or psychological artifacts. It's a pretty radical thing for such a empiricist, you know, Anglo-American empiricist to say. So Putnam was very interested in this argument, this idea that what logicians and mathematicians and scientists represent as a priori arguments, that is, they rest on these eternal foundations of logical principles, like A can't be not A, and, you know, whatever, like the law of the excluded middle, if you know that part of the story, that there are these fundamental logical principles that just are for all time. And Quine's like, no. And Putnam's like, no. And what Putnam points to as evidence for this is what he calls the weirdness of physics. So he starts pointing to these strange principles of indeterminacy and the collapse of the wave function. And he says, look, this stuff is deeply weird. And there's two ways to interpret it. One is you don't interpret it. You say, let's just make it work. And so you have a pragmatic, instrumental relationship, and you just go about your business, you don't worry about it. Or you go, you're a philosopher. Maybe reality just isn't logical that way, or at least all of the time. And therefore, that these laws of thought, these laws of reality, are actually, as Rupert Sheldrake talked about, more like habits. And so this notion of quantum weirdness is not just saying that reality is weird in some ways, it's that even the fundamentals of the way in which we think as rationalists, as people trying to understand the world, constructing knowledge, etc., that if you dig down to the axioms, which is always what you should do when you're in philosophical arguments, ignore the surface. What are their axiomatic principles? What are their assumptions about what's going down? And if you dig down to the axioms, you find something that's a lot more wiggy than a lot of people want to let you know of. So I'm going to end with one final concept as I have my 1 minute. Oh my God, maybe I won't. I'll just show you the pictures. No, this is my final image. And the reason I put this up here is because I have written about visionary art. I love visionary art, contemporary visionary art, but I also think that it's gotten stuck in some terrible cliches and some terribly bad habits. And this image I bring up because this is an early image from Luke Brown, who's one of the artists who helped define the kind of contemporary visionary art style, and indeed also produced some of what are now have become cliches with these symmetrical images, and you have a god face right in the middle, and it's kind of, you know, so whatever. And but what I love about this image is it's just so weird. I mean, it's like, and I remember, I've been there, and it's like, I don't know if I can deal with this. And it's like, you know, it's the cartoons have come alive, and they want something from you, and you don't know what, they're not going to tell you, and they won't stop, and you know. And I'll leave you with this final sort of note, which I think is also a way of capturing the sort of even adolescent, sticky, goofy aspect of the psychedelic weird, which is, you know, I've been writing about this stuff forever, and I was writing about it when it wasn't cool, and then I managed, someone gave let me get a PhD on it, so it's, you know, I'd like to say I have a PhD in high weirdness. But I was thinking, like, what am I doing, like, trying to write about this stuff analytically and put it into academic language? What am I really doing? I mean, what am I really doing? And the reality is that when I was a teenager, I got this gum stuck on my shoe, this weird psychedelic, like, what the fuck is this? And, you know, I'm just kind of trying to pass it on to you. Yeah.